Thank you very much for the invitation to this closing day. And actually, even though I was not a very systematic participant in this trimester, I really enjoyed it because it's true I hadn't spent much time in my life thinking about the quantum world. So I think I learned many things. Now, I have to find how to change. Should I do it from here? So first a disclaimer, you know, I think I was asked, I'm not totally sure. The right button, okay. I think I was asked by these three gentlemen, the organizers, to talk about string theory in a way that non-specialists will get at least something out of it, epsilon out of it. Even though I see some of my string theory friends in the audience, I can tell them right away that they will not learn much from this talk. But hopefully I will convey a little bit to the others, to the people that haven't been working in the subject. And anyway, with this in mind, well, I'm not going to speak about my results or my recent results. I will just put in perspective a few, I think, well-established facts by my standards of mathematical rigor, and comment a little bit on the recent literature in relation with the issues that were raised in this quantum trimester. So it's some kind of poor man's version of a Bourbaki seminar. And talking of Bourbaki, you know, I was surfing one day. I didn't have anything better to do. I was surfing on the internet and I fell on this blog from a young American mathematician who happened, it was a she, and she was in Paris one afternoon as a tourist, and she heard about the Bourbaki seminar. She dropped by, but she didn't speak French. So she says, something interesting happens when you are really lost. You notice things that otherwise might not register. For example, I noticed I was one of two women in the crowd, and of about 40 plus people. From the picture on the left, you can also see that the median age is probably about 50. Also, it's apparently okay to fall asleep at the seminar Bourbaki. And that holds here too, you know, feel free if. Now here are a very brief outline of what I will try to say. I will spend very little time, 5 minutes hopefully, just to say a few generalities about string theory. Of course, there's no chance I can do any justice to the subject. I will just make some general remarks. Then I will talk a little bit about singularities. Again, the way in which singularities have been considered in string theory. And here I'm talking about mostly singularities of space-time. And then in the last two parts, I will try to talk to you about horizons and entropy and about the emergent geometry. And again, some of my friends here, I see Yosif, will probably have much more to add. We can see as things go to the end. Okay. Now, so some generalities, first of all. Let me just try to set, to put the setting somewhere. No proofs in whatever I say, you know, trust me that things are usually proven to the satisfaction of a physicist, not of a mathematician or a mathematical physicist. But these statements usually are considered, you know, sufficiently solid so as not to pose questions. So, as you all know, here is the story we have. We have a relativistic quantum field theory. That's the standard model. It's pretty well defined. You can put it in some grand unified group. It's asymptotically free. So, again, for a physicist, this means that it can be defined in principle at all distance scales, all the way to the deep ultraviolet. Then this lives in a classical background, and the classical background is indeed described by the Einstein-Hilbert classical action. And we heard Klaus this morning talking to us about quantum field theory in classical geometry, And I think this doesn't run into any direct clash at all with present-day observations. Treat geometry classically, treat the quantum field theory in the background. Of course, there is a lot of, you know, rigor that can go into this, and this was explained this morning. But a priori, from the point of view of a physicist, you know, things seem to work perfectly fine. Now, of course, many things may hide in the sky, but again, there are three at least reasons why this story is not satisfactory. There is an optional problem, because some people think the solution is outside physics, it's in metaphysics, anthropic or otherwise, of dark energy, right? That's the one thing no one has a good theory or beginning of a theory of understanding. Then there are obvious conceptual problems, conceptually incomplete issues. Should one think of geometries as coherent or mixed quantum states? And what about the information paradox of black holes? And finally, anyway, the theory is even mathematically incomplete, and the reason are singularities of general relativity. So, you know, you cannot simply assume that Einstein's theory is the end of the story, because the theory has generic singularities, and that's where you have to do something, put boundary conditions, say something more, do something more. So I think everyone agrees that something should be done at the latest at the Planck scale. And actually, you know, people have tried all sorts of things for years, and the most timid ideas run very quickly into difficulties. You know, the most trivial idea would be to say, well, let's deform Einstein's theory to make it renormalizable. It's okay for a Euclidean gravity, but it has ghosts when you try to go to Lorentzian signature, so this doesn't work. Then I think the idea goes back probably to Sakharov first, who said, well, you know, maybe gravity is some kind of hydrodynamics. It should, in a sense, emerge from some regular quantum field theory in the same way that hydrodynamics emerges from atomic or molecular physics. And actually, at least in a simple version, this was ruled out by the so-called Weinberg-Witten theorem. This is a very simple kind of theorem. It's a theorem that, again, theorem by my standards, not by yours or many of the people in the audience. It's a statement that says that there cannot be a massless spin 2 state in a theory that has a conserved energy momentum tensor and relativistic invariance. And the theorem is really sort of trivial. All you have to do is show that there is a matrix element of the energy momentum tensor between two states that has to be non-zero. It has to be non-zero because the energy is a conserved quantity. So if you integrate T00, you should get E. And furthermore, Lorentz invariance, you can check, quickly forces you to write down this as the answer. But this is obviously inconsistent. If you have J spin bigger than one particles, simply because this quantity on the left does not have consistent transformation properties if you try to rotate by an angle phi around the momentum and the spin projection of the particles P and P prime. You know, it's a pretty trivial statement. Simply, this is the vector representation of the Lorentz group, and if J is bigger than one, you cannot make this work.
Are you taking questions during your lecture or only after the lecture?
No, I'm happy to, if they don't divert me too much. I mean, this is very
interesting. I do linearized gravity, which was done a long time ago.
Yes.
Then I have a spin, a helicity 2 massless particle.
Yes, but there is no conserved energy momentum tensor.
Should it be conserved in a theory of gravity?
Okay, it shouldn't. So this simply tells you that if you had a theory like QED with only spins, This tells me that if I have a theory like QED, right, a theory that has a local conserved energy momentum tensor, this theory cannot have states with spin bigger than one and massless. Okay, it cannot have massless gravitons. You know, that's all it tells you. So if you take a regular quantum field theory, there is no way you will ever construct a massless bound state of spin 2. So of course, if you start with linearized gravity, you know, that's a different story. But there the answer is that mu nu is not defined. And actually, you know, basically, I don't want to go into the details. You have to define gauge invariant or BRST invariant states, and that's the way you get out of this contradiction. So
conserved means ordinary.
D mu t mu nu is zero in Minkowski space time. Okay, that's.
So the covariant conservation is not. This is.
No, that's Minkowski. It's all Minkowski space time. No, take a relativistic quantum.
I wanted to know if this theorem applies only with the ordinary derivative in Minkowski space time.
Yes, 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 because I'm using actually Lorentz covariance for the argument. You need both things, a local conserved energy momentum tensor and Lorentz covariance. Okay. Yeah. And indeed, gauge theories get away from this because of gauge invariance. There is no conserved local current. Now, you know, people have tried all sorts of things. For instance, one way to evade the theorem is to break Lorentz symmetry, either explicitly or spontaneously. Bjorken, I think, did it first. Many other people tried. But all this looks to me extremely contrived, and I don't think it ever went very far. It has been revived over the years, including more recently by Horava, but I don't think this manages to go all the way. And of course, the most plausible thing that people have been saying is that, well, if you are going to have the graviton emerge as a bound state, then probably space-time should emerge too. Well, these are words, they sound like reasonable words, but the amazing thing in some ways, and that's the only point where I will put the word amazing or miraculous, is that somehow perturbative string theory has evaded these first stumbling blocks in a much more conventional way. You know, it has circumvented these original no-go statements in a very conventional way, actually. And one may say that Dirac is really the father of this theory, both because he wrote this marvelous little paper where he tried to compute the mass of the muon as the first excited state of a membrane, and also, of course, because he never believed in a renormalization. You know, he thought that there should be some well-defined theory in the UV, and one should never take infinities and limits, you know. Okay, now, so again, three words about string theory. I'm not going to explain, of course, all the mathematical details, but essentially one way to state it is the following. There is a deformation of geometry, of classical geometry, that one may call the alpha prime deformation or the sigma model deformation. So the starting point is a two-dimensional field theory. This is the quantum mechanics for a simple string that propagates in some background metric and extra fields. This is called the dilaton. And now, for consistency, one has to actually assume scale invariance of this two-dimensional sigma model. Basically, the two-dimensional auxiliary metric has to completely get out of the picture because it's not part of the degrees of freedom of the propagating string. Now, one of the most beautiful discoveries, I think, starting with Friedan's thesis, is the fact that indeed the beta function equations for this two-dimensional sigma model give gradient flow derived from some action or C function. And I have written down the first few terms of this function, which turns out to play the role of the classical deformation of the Einstein-Hilbert theory. So it has the Einstein term, and then you see it has a series of higher curvature corrections with very well-defined coefficients. People compute them. And this is simply the beta function or sigma model deformation, which in math language, if you want, is Ricci flow, but corrected by the appropriate higher order terms. Anyway, the upshot of all this is that geometry or classical Einstein theory is in a sense replaced by conformal invariant sigma models. And I think this is an example of a deformation. You know, when you come from some other directions, one tries to deform consistently Einstein's theory. That's a deformation. It does all sorts of nice things. It has no ghosts, and this can be shown. It always has a spin 2 massless state in the spectrum of this string. So in a sense, it is a bound state, but not of a finite number of quantum fields, but of some string. Yeah. And by the way, the fact that this should be massless uses very crucially quantum mechanics, namely the fact that when you compute the mass operator for the string, it starts out as minus one. That's due to quantum fluctuations of the string. You know, there is some kind of Casimir mass. And if it weren't for this minus one, you would never get a massless spin 2 particle out of fluctuating string.
Costa, when you said no ghost, in which sense? Because when you have alpha prime, I mean nu sigma, etc., I mean nu sigma.
Up to this stage, there is ghost. But if you resum the infinite series, and of course you are not doing it like this, you basically go directly to the spectrum of the string, and then you can check that there is no ghost.
No, but this A, I mean nu sigma, etc., it's some kind of collective degrees of freedom.
This?
I mean, which are coming from this alpha
prime. Yes, absolutely, yes.
They are collective degree of freedom. Mm-hmm. And, okay, if I am solving an equation just up to alpha prime, I am getting the terms actually which behave like ghosts.
Absolutely.
So what
absolutely
happens with
the... Well, you have to resum. So the ghost up to this order would appear at the scale alpha prime, the string scale.
Very good.
If you resum the infinite series, it goes away.
You don't see directly, but what could you, because nobody resounds the series which you want.
Yes, because that's not how you do it, but you can do it differently. You just quantize the string, calculate the S matrix and so on, and then you see that the S matrix has no
ghost.
The
so string has no ghost.
Yes.
Okay, but
yeah.
So therefore you can prove that.
Yeah.
But so it means that in this kind of extra mode, you should not trust which appears from this term.
You shouldn't trust this truncated action up to R squared if you are going to talk about things at the scale of the string. So anyway, this is clearly a fascinating deformation of classical geometry. It has given rise to all sorts of beautiful mathematics. You know, mirror symmetry came out of this, non-geometric backgrounds, things that have absolutely no geometric counterpart, also sometimes called asymmetric orbifolds, have come out of this. And it's clearly a very rich mathematical subject, and it's also something that allows you then to go on and compute the things that a naive quantum field theorist wanted to compute, things like one or two loop scattering of gravitons that give you finite answers with no ambiguities. And again, this has, you know, been developed by many people, in particular Pierre Van Hove and Michael Green here. There are beautiful mathematics in calculating all this. That's essentially where I will stop about general string theory. I just want to make one more remark, that it is a theory where no external sources are allowed because only on-shell quantities are non-divergent or finite. As soon as you try to go off-shell or put some external source, you don't know anymore how to calculate all these finite things. So in a sense, the no mass of quantum mechanics that Thibault mentioned the other day is also a no mass of string theory.
It's claimed that finally Witten proved that it is completely ultraviolet finite. Is this believable?
Well, so, you know, the claim is that if you find any divergence, it can always be converted to an infrared divergence. Infrared divergences we are used to, we are not worried by them. They simply tell us we don't understand something about the ground state, and we don't understand many things about the ground state. Now, I don't think there is really more of a, I mean, this is something you can prove by your hands. You know, you deform Riemann surfaces and you show that the dangers come from boundaries of moduli space of the Riemann surface, and those can always be reinterpreted as infrared problems. And, you know, Wilton has tried to indeed write down very carefully the Docker and Fong first, the measure of the supermoduli integrations. I don't believe there is a proof. No, if you ask me, there is no, even for me, there is no proof. But it sounds like a very reasonable statement.
But isn't it also that ambiguities in defining this measure that sort of start growing after five loops?
Yes.
And as he claims that...
But the ambiguities are due to gauge fixings. Yeah, okay. I mean, let's not get... You know, in a sense, if you had said to someone 40 years ago, compute a two-loop graviton scattering amplitude and you will get a finite answer, a physicist would be perfectly happy with this, might even tell you we never see anything beyond two loops anyway. But it's true that that's something that has to be proven, and it would be a great achievement if, you know, there is finally a proof. But, you know, for someone, again, more heuristic and naively minded like me, you may say, okay, all this is marvelous, why aren't we done? You know, what's the story? We have a nice deformation of geometry, it seems to do all sorts of marvelous things. Well, there is a pragmatic and a foundational answer to this. The pragmatic one, I think, is clear. The connection to the observed low-energy world is incomplete. And this raises very hard problems. Supersymmetry is essential. When you break it, the divergences can creep up again. The Sitter space doesn't arise naturally, so our accelerating universe doesn't arise naturally. And there seem to be indeed problems of how to select a vacuum that is stable and resembles our low energy world. So in a sense, this, you know, for a physicist, clearly the big problems, if one wants to one day make contact with the real world, are essentially there. But from a more foundational, yes.
What is a vacuum in what you stated here?
Well, yeah, okay, so, you know, this is a theory in 10 dimensions. Our world looks four-dimensional. You have to, therefore, find some compact manifold.
My question is, how is defined a vacuum state in this theory?
So a poor man's way would be something that looks like Minkowski, empty space, or the Sitter with an extremely large radius of curvature. Okay. Again, I'm not going to talk about this because there's a more foundational problem, which is time. And in the sense, in the rest of the talk, I think I will mostly talk about this, show to you what I mean, really. But, you know, since Slava mentions all these great Russian physicists, and I'm Greek, I thought I should find some Greek here. And in a sense, the first guys that tried to do a phenomenology of time were the pre-Socratics. You know? And there are these marvelous sayings of Heraclitus, who basically noticed two phenomenological things about time that are absolutely true. Time flows, and there are no closed time-like geodesics. And this is the Greek translation for the phrase that you never get into the same river twice. Right. It's not obvious. Yes, ποταμίσι τίσιν αυτίσιν εμβαίνουσιν έτερα και έτερα είδα τα υπηρή, which means sort of you think you get into the same river twice, but the water and you have changed. Right. So that sounds trivial, no? It's not Erasmian, yeah, it's, I'm sorry. Yeah. Anyway, so now time. So just to summarize, you know, string theory, I think, avoids some of the first traps on the road to a theory of quantum gravity. But as I will now try to argue, issues with time are crucial and not at all understood. So let me start with singularities, actually. No, so string theory has been indeed very successful in resolving singularities. I'll give you a few examples of those. These are places where the geometry, the geometric Einstein description breaks down. And in GR, one would have to supplement the quantum field theory that lives on it. One would have to supplement the theory by ad hoc boundary conditions. For instance, here is an orbifold. It is simply Rn modded out by some discrete group of the rotation group. It has a conical tip singularity. And if you try to do general relativity and QFT on it, you need to give some ad hoc prescription for what happens here.
It is only time-like singularities.
These are exactly, yes. Now, string theory resolves this, and the way it does is that it gives you a very precise set of so-called twisted states, basically strings that go around the singularity. You can quantize them. They live near the singularity because it takes a lot of energy or mass to get away. So there are these localized degrees of freedom. They can be massless. And so the singularities that you think you get are completely resolved because there are these new massless states that you didn't see in general relativity. And if you do any scattering or anything else, you may excite them. And again, remember the motto is that if you see singularities, they are infrared. It's because you forgot some massless infrared degrees of freedom. And that's exactly what happens here.
Costas, okay, yes. In which sense it resolves? In a sense, the string goes and then doesn't feel this singularity, or in a sense that beyond this singularity, you can unambiguously solve equation for the background.
No, no, in the sense that in this space, I can calculate for you unambiguously, say, as matrix elements, even if the incoming particles seem to propagate to the tip of the cone.
No, but on the side of the background, okay, with this singularity, you can say also that the equations which determine your background, for them, Cauchy problem is completely well defined.
Yes. You see, of course, I could do the following.
How you would expand your space?
There's nothing beyond. There's none. That's, you know, that's where space is.
So space is with singularity, just for this matrix problem, this singularity is irrelevant. This is what you want.
You see, if I were doing quantum field theory, I would have to round off this thing and then define my story, but there would be a total ambiguity on how do you round it off, and you get different answers for different smoothings and so on. So string theory gives you a prescription. That's what one means resolve. Basically, it tells you what to do at this point. Now, there are various other examples. Maybe I won't describe them all. One of the most famous ones are so-called deep brains, and the deep brains are, again, singularities in space-time, but where instead of these localized twisted modes, you get open strings. That's the thing that sticks to this space-time defect. You know, it's something singular in space-time. It is characterized by the fact that an open string sticks to it. The open strings also can be massless. And again, that's how you resolve these deep brain singularities in a very precise way. In particular, again, you can do scattering. And you get exact answers if you allow for the possibility that open strings can also get excited in the scattering. Then there is something called the conifold. Maybe I will skip this. The novelty of the conifold, that's simply some singular Calabi-Yau manifold. The novelty is that the massless degrees of freedom are not strings, as in the previous two examples, but wrapped membranes, or D2 brains, and various things have been checked also here. But here is an example that probably anyone that has worked on geometry knows. It is the so-called Taub-Nut metric. So this is one of the very nice metrics in four dimensions with the topology of R3 cross a circle. This metric, you see, or maybe you don't see, anyway, here is the explicit metric. And if you think of it by dimensionally reducing to three dimensions, so you forget this compact circle, actually the manifold looks like a cigar, as one says. That's how it looks, where x equals to zero is the tip of the cigar. There's no singularity there. It's simply locally R4. But if you try to dimensionally reduce this circle, what you will find exactly is essentially the Dirac monopole, so some singular solution of three dimensional Euclidean geometry, but of course in one more dimension there is no singularity at all. This is a perfectly smooth manifold. And what are the massless modes, localized modes at the singularity here? They are simply Kaluza-Klein modes, right? So modes that...
Singularity, first of all, yes. Singularities which are resolved are not singularities in which person and me would be ever interested, okay? Perhaps, because it's not singularities like in black hole, it's not singularities like in universe.
No, but I'm coming to this now. Yeah, you are running, yeah. But these are singularities, you know. If
these singularities are also singularities from the point of view of curvature invariance. Like scalar curvature is infinite.
That's a good point. So, of course, in this example, the answer is no. Yes. But in the deep brain example, the answer is yes. Yes, you can get curvatures diverge if you just take naive gravity or supergravity solutions.
You trust this singularity because you know that...
I don't trust, yeah.
Singularity itself, okay, not how string field. Yes. Because when curvature becomes of the order of the Planckian curvature, you know that these solutions, okay, are not trustable because all terms, for instance, your alpha prime expansion becomes of the same order.
Yes, so you should not do an expansion, that's what I'm trying to say. You know, you should direct it.
String theory does it.
That's what string theory does. You don't do an expansion, I mean, that's the whole point. But hold your question, I mean, maybe we can discuss it. Because the key thing I want to say is what Thibault already said. All these singularities are time-like. Actually, whenever we resolve a singularity in string theory, time is an idle spectator. So these things are things that, you know, stay there for all time. And with space-like or light-like singularities, string theory has had remarkably less success. Actually, I might even say no success. You know? And it's not because people haven't tried. You know, people have tried all sorts of things. For instance, orbifolds, folds, but where you just mod out by a Lorentz transformation, say indefinite metric spaces, or simply weak rotating, say Taubnat solutions, or things I will mention them in a moment called S-brains, or more recently the so-called De Sitter CFT correspondence. Nothing seems to work, at least in any reasonable manner. So clearly there is a problem. Here is actually an amusing analogy. It will show to you a little bit what I mean. We wrote this little, totally unnoticed article with Marc Henault and Claudio Buster. Just think about 2+1-dimensional electrodynamics and define a source to the Bianchi identity. You know, this is df equals to zero usually, but let's put a source that plays the role of the Dirac monopole in 3+1 dimensions. So if I was in 3+1 and time was a spectator, here this would be a monopole, but I am in 2+1, that's crucial. And now you may say, what is this? That's something singular. For a Dirac monopole, we know how to resolve the singularity by going, for instance, to some non-abelian theory and writing down a Tuft monopole, a Tuft-Polyakov monopole. But how about this simple theory? Well, first of all, if you think about what this source does, it does the following thing. We called it an event. It simply deposes G units of magnetic flux at some space-time point. And then this, of course, follows the free equations and simply expands in a light cone. And there is the anti-event where you basically focus a beam of light in these 2+1 dimensions to a space-time point, and there it disappears. Okay. So now you may say, well, can string theory resolve this kind of thing? The answer is it does, but it does in a very bizarre way, well, in an unconventional way. First of all, you can check the little paper. That's the essential, non-trivial statement there, that there is some analog of Dirac's quantization condition. What you can do is try to calculate in this simple model what happens to a charged particle in the presence of the event. And there is a topological answer. It doesn't depend on the details of the event here, only on the long-range fields. And the topological answer is that the particle acquires angular momentum, which is eg over 2 pi. And if this is quantized, the coefficient g has to also be quantized. But you see, it comes, there's no Dirac string here. It comes from a very different argument. Anyway, so string theory resolves this singularity as follows, and you will see the difference. It resolves it with the help of an extra dimension. So that's exactly what happens. There is this object I call the D2 brain, and the equations on a D2 brain are precisely the equations of 2 plus 1 dimensional electrodynamics, it turns out. So believe me for this. But now this D2 brain lives in some higher dimensional space, and actually magnetic flux is confined outside it, but can be carried by a particle, that's called the D particle. And therefore the process I just showed to you corresponds to some D particle coming in from outside. The flux is confined, it cannot spread, it hits the surface and then it spreads. Okay. By the way, you can actually try to do this in an experiment in a Josephson junction. The words are exactly the same in a Josephson
junction. It has been observed in the last game.
We are not very good at convincing experiment. Maybe, you know, someone should try maybe to convince them to do this experiment. I can tell you more about this. Yeah. The point I want to stress here is that in this example, singular events are generic. You know, a D particle can hit, while anti-events require absolute fine-tuning of initial data. One can easily generalize this to higher dimensions, but the main point is that the resolution, unlike that of time-like singularities, is very different. You see, a time-like singularity here would be resolved by embedding in an non-abelian theory, which does the resolution of the Dirac monopole, but this doesn't help here, you can check. The resolution depends on initial conditions in an extra dimension. So, how to transplant this to a gravity theory, and does it make you any wiser? I'm not sure, but this is the kind of problem that people that try to talk about S-brains and Ekpyrosis and all sorts of things are facing, you know. The resolution seems to depend on initial conditions in a non-trivial manner. So, to summarize this, string theory resolves all sorts of time-like singularities, but space-like singularities pose a different challenge. So before I go on, I'm happy to stop and... Yes?
I just want to make a comment that somehow the distinction between time-like and space-like is not so drastic. If you have a Schwarzschild black hole, which is, you know, the mass of the galaxy, and you put one electron, the singularity becomes time-like.
Yeah, I'm going to come to this, so maybe we should discuss.
It's a big distance. I mean, no, but mathematically it looks very different, but physically it doesn't.
I don't agree, of course, Yosif, but let's discuss it. I mean, I'm going to comment on this. Now, precisely, I want to come now to entropy and horizons. So the singularities I talked about up to now have no degeneracy. Namely, in a sense, there are not many quantum states there. And one way to say it is that all these localized modes I talked about are generically in their ground state, or if not, they just escape to infinity, and you are back into a non-degenerate singularity. So what happens to degenerate singularities? Now, the simplest example are the so-called extremal two-charge black holes. So I'm going to come to where Yosif is pointing. Here is an example. So suppose you take a string. Now, it happens to be an heterotic string here. It winds around some compact circle a number of times, call it W. But it also has some momentum in this same direction, which is quantized in units of the inverse radius, because the wave function has to be single-valued. So the momentum is n over r, and n and w are the two charges I referred to here. So this is, you know, some kind of string. It has these two charges that are obviously conserved. You cannot undo the winding. you cannot destroy momentum, you know, it's a conserved quantity. And one can check that the mass of the string is bigger or equal than some lowest possible value. It's called the extremal value, which is n over r plus 2 pi r, the winding number, times the tension of the string. And now one can also easily check that this has, there are a number of degenerate quantum states of this system, and the entropy in the extremal case is exactly given in the large nw limit by 4 pi square root nw. So that's simply, you know, quantizing a free string would give you this answer. So the number of states grows as the charges become larger and larger. Now, when we say, well, here is a particle that has entropy and two charges, let's think about the corresponding gravity solution. In this case, I only had a compact circle, so I'm in 9 non-compact dimensions. Super is there because it's always there for convenience in string theory, otherwise things get ugly, but I will get to that too. And you write down the supergravity solutions, and they happen to be singular, actually. And the reason why they are singular is that it's not only metric, unfortunately here, or fortunately, there are many other fields, including scalar fields, like the radius of compactification. You know, this cannot be, of course, a constant. It's a field in gravity. It can change from one point to the other. And the dilaton is another one. And it turns out that with two charges, you can never equilibrate the scalars to finite values. Just to understand why, you know, think of the system. If there was only winding, it would tend to shrink the circle to zero. If there was only momentum, it would tend to blow it up, radiation, pressure, but both of them manage to stabilize it to some optimal value. So the radius is stabilized, but the dilaton is not by these two charge solutions. And actually, it's really a tour de force that several people, including Atish, have Double Car have succeeded in doing. Precisely, that's one case where they managed to sum up these alpha prime corrections in a precise way and to show that even though it's a singular solution of Einstein theory, it is a non-singular solution of this infinitely corrected theory by these higher order terms. And not only this, but by using Wald's generalization of the entropy formula, you can match exactly this 4 pi square root nw by just calculating the horizon area of this black hole. So these are sometimes called small black holes. They are, of course, very interesting in a sense, but I don't want to continue with them. Yes.
If you sum up, okay, this alpha-prime correction, is there an explicit formula for the summing up, or it's just...
Yes, there is, not for all quantities, but for the entropy of an extremal black hole. Yes.
So you cannot write equations, but how you know that singularities are removed? Because for singularities you have to have equations which are solved.
You can see that I think already the R-square correction suffices to smooth the solution in the sense of creating a horizon, if you put the first two terms. But then, you know, the whole point is, can you exactly calculate the area, or actually the Wald equivalent of the area in this system? And that's what these people have done. And if you do it, you find...
But the ground without singularity, you also can describe, I mean, corrected the ground which satisfies all these corrected equations, which take into account of alpha prime corrections, without singularities. By what is replaced the ground, if you would have it?
Yeah, it's some you go near the singularity, it's the usual solution of Einstein theory, and then very close to the singularity, it changes. And it creates a horizon, that's what I'm telling you.
Ah, okay, so it creates horizon, yes. But you can go...
I don't want to go behind, I'm not sure, because you will see that going behind is an issue. But what I'm trying to say is that here is a singularity, you know, that's the summary, is a singularity that has degeneracy, it has entropy, it is apparently being resolved by string theory, but it's all happening again at the string or the Planck scale at very, very short distances. So it's, you know, a better version or a more rich version of the resolutions we have already seen, but nothing drastic yet. Well, it's something, you know.
If it's also a time-like singularity or space-like?
That I'm not sure, actually. Maybe Yosif knows this. Time-like. I think it's time-like, yeah, because it's extreme.
It's extreme,
no, so it's nil. It's yeah. Right.
It's not at the beginning.
The classical condition has an horizon which collapses with the singularity.
But what about large black holes? And now that's where things start becoming more interesting, because if we now repeat this thing, but to a system where the horizon grows to very large size, then why on earth would Einstein theory break down? Or if it does, what happens? Okay, here you see it breaks down because curvatures are large, but in a very large black hole, the curvatures are almost zero at the horizon. So that's where things start becoming more interesting. Now, the famous three-charge example is the Strom-Jervafa black hole. Doesn't matter, you know, how you make it up. Here is, in a sense, a cartoon version of the Ising model of this black hole. It has D5 brains, D1 brains, and Kaluza-Klein modes that move up and down. And the whole thing is wrapping a 5-torus, a 4-torus times a circle. And the number of 5 brains, the number of strings, and the number of Kaluza-Klein modes, or the momentum, are the three charges. And again, believe you solve the supergravity equations. There is now a big macroscopic horizon for large charges. And there is now a real Bekenstein-Hawking formula, area over 4GH bar, which is given by these charges. And this is an example where you can count states of a black hole. So it tells you that at least the microscopic picture cannot be totally crazy. Now, this kind of black hole, so now I'm going to get close to what Yosif is saying, this is really basically a generalization of the charged black hole in four-dimensional Einstein plus Maxwell theory. So here is the metric for a charged black hole. It looks like the Schwarzschild metric. The scale factor F, or the redshift factor F, has a somewhat different form. You see it's quadratic in 1/r. There are two places where it vanishes. They are called outer and inner horizons. They are given by the mass and the charge in terms of this formulae. And again, there is an entropy, the area of the horizon over G, and the temperature, which is the difference of these two radii. So T equals to zero is the extremal case where the mass is equal to the charge and the square root vanishes, and that's, in a sense, the ground state of this system. Okay. Now, here is indeed a very interesting proposal, and Yosif is one of the people that has worked a lot on this, which has occupied people for almost 10 years now. And one proposal, which goes by the name of fuzzball, is to say the following. So, you know, I showed you some deep brains, and we could do some counting that measures exactly the number of microstates of the system. But could these microstates be simply encoded in the geometry? Okay. Now, this goes against folklore theorems called no-hair theorems, which are basically valid in four dimensions, and which tell you that outside the horizon of a black hole, once it has settled down to the ground state, there is not much. You only see the electromagnetic fields that carry the charge or couple to the charge, but nothing else. Now, this folklore theorem clearly fails, actually, in higher dimensions. So the folklore says that there are no gravitational solitons other than black holes. there are many, many evasion windows and pitfalls with a very illustrious prehistory. Apparently, this is the only wrong paper of Pauli, I'm told. Pauli wrote a paper with Einstein on the non-existence of regular stationary solutions of relativistic field equations in 43, and they had in mind the Kaluza-Klein theory in five dimensions. And I just told you right before that there are monopole solutions, the Taub-Nampt metric, that are obviously smooth and that are not black holes. They are just regular solutions, solitons of Kaluza-Klein theory. Now the argument, the reason why their argument was wrong is that they used some wrong scaling argument. You can look at the paper, which is always amazing and reconforting to know that even these people can make a mistake.
The theorem of Lichnowitz, which was a
letter,
which is also wrong for
many. Yes, absolutely. Now, the key to evasion is basically non-trivial topology, and there is a very nice recent paper of Gibbons and Warner that puts the dots on the i's in the particular case of five-dimensional supergravity with two supersymmetries. I'm not sure how I'm doing with time. Who is counting time?
10 more minutes.
Oh, then I want to maybe skip this proof. But essentially, the way what they show in a very general setting is that if you consider a five-dimensional gravity theory, well, supergravity, it has some extra stuff, and a stationary or static solution, this means that you assume a time-like Killing vector kappa, then the existence of non-trivial second homology, so non-trivial two cycles on the spatial sections is enough to give you stable solitons, and they exhibit a large number of them, and basically you can avoid the simple no-go theorem because of some Chan-Simons term. You can look at the proof if you want afterwards. So one can avoid this, and a lot of hard work has gone into trying to generate enough of these solutions to account for the entropy of the three-charge black hole. Now, at the end of my talk, maybe Yosif will want to add things or make a comment. Let me just make the following statement. You know, remember, these would be now solutions that look perfectly like black holes, but when you get close to the horizon, space will end somehow in some smooth manner. So in a sense, there is neither horizon nor interior of the black hole in the usual sense. Now, of course, it would be a great mathematical achievement if the entropy of these things could be accounted for by smooth 11-dimensional geometries, supergravity geometries. I'm personally skeptical, and indeed because I'm not sure I agree with the earlier comment of Yosif, in a sense, a baby version of this are multicenter Taub-Nut geometries in five dimension. These are perfectly smooth solutions of five-dimensional Kaluza-Klein theory. They mimic an extremal four-dimensional charged black hole from far away. There is no doubt about this. But does this really imply a breakdown of effective field theory for some infalling observer that should normally see a very flat, almost empty horizon, as general relativity usually tells us? Now, my take is that in most of these general relativity theorems or statements, one always makes an assumption of genericity, as for thermodynamics, and things that happen here look extremely non-generic. Another way to say it is precisely if you draw the Penrose diagram of a charged Reissner-Nostrum black hole. Let me again not explain it because I want to go to the last part. But the singularities of this geometry are indeed time-like. They are hiding behind the second horizon. So this is the outer horizon. This is the second horizon. This is the region in between. And D'Affermos and others have shown that a priori this Cauchy horizon, as it is called, is completely unstable to any small perturbation and should collapse to space-like singularities. So I think, well, but I cannot prove it, that we are still in a situation where we don't have space-like singularities, and one would have to really exhibit cases with space-like singularities to make the fuzzball case more convincing. Now, again, I'm holding off Yosif's probably a rebuttal to this, but I want to now, in the last 10 minutes, go to the last question, which I think poses a very sharp problem that many people have been pondering the last 2 or 3 years, which is the question of emergent geometry. Okay, now all these issues come into very sharp focus in the context of the so-called ADS-CFT. So I will tell you exactly what I mean. Now, even if you are not a string theorist, you must have surely heard that there is this conjecture which says that on-shell quantum gravity with asymptotic anti-de Sitter boundary conditions at spatial infinity is equivalent to an ordinary relativistic conformal field theory or quantum field theory in one less dimension or on the boundary of the space. And the most famous and studied example is quantum gravity in ADS5 cross S5 and N equal 4 four-dimensional Young-Mills theory. Now, Young-Mills theory is unitary, everyone would agree, even though, again, maybe proving it won't be necessarily easy. So if the correspondence is right, one should have states that resemble black holes. That's, I think, obvious. So here we have a very well-posed problem. How does the geometry of this anti-de Sitter space emerge from a regular conformal field theory? In particular, of course, one should evade Witten's theorem, Weinberg-Witten's theorem, but this we know can be evaded in a string theory. Now, to start and to see that this is a hard question, clearly this is a very hard question, but here is what you can do. Consider first empty anti-de Sitter. This is empty anti-de Sitter. You see it's flat space-time and one radial dimension, so that things get blue-shifted or red-shifted as you move uniformly, as you move in the radial dimension. Okay, now, Z is one of the coordinates of the gravity theory, but not of the conformal field theory. So the conformal field theory indeed only has operators that depend on X. Okay, let me take one of these operators. It's a conformal theory, so it has some scaling dimension delta. And now there is a dictionary that I won't describe, but which allows you to formally write down something like a free gravitational field in the bulk. So you take this operator, you Fourier transform it, then you sum over, these are solutions of the free wave equation in anti-de Sitter space with appropriate mass related to the scaling dimension. You see, I write this as phi CFT because this is entirely defined in a quantum field theory. There is no gravity. However, it's easy to show, you know, that's very simple, by just looking at the two-point function of this operator in CFT, that this has exactly the properties you expect of a free quantum field in anti-de Sitter. And actually, in the limit of the number of colors to infinity, this has only two-point functions. That's part of this large N factorization, so it looks really like a free field. But now, what does it mean to find locality in the bulk geometry of this theory? Well, we know that what this means is that if, say, you do a four-point scattering of these fields, you should find an answer that falls off very rapidly unless the wave packets that you formed come into the same point in space-time of five dimensions, right? So, I mean, these are free fields. Now I'm going to make them interact to leading order in 1 over n. Okay, so just regular perturbation theory. And I want to understand why this interaction would look local not in the X mu's only, but also in Z. No, Z was a made-up coordinate. It didn't appear a priori in the conformal field theory. Now, that's a very non-trivial question, actually, and it hasn't been answered, really. You know, there's really marvelous mathematical progress to calculating exactly the four-point functions of super Young-Mills, for all values of the couplings, this would answer this question if we had the answer, but all this technology is completely on shell in the conformal field theory, so you can only take the external operators to have light-like momentum, and clearly here we need off-shell quantities in the conformal field theory to calculate on-shell scattering in the gravity theory. So even this simple fact, empty anti-de Sitter, has not yet been fully tested, but there are very indirect but very convincing arguments that if the conformal theory is of a special kind, namely it has a gap in the scaling dimensions for operators of spin bigger than 2, and by just looking at the structure of conformal blocks, there is convincing evidence that this theory gives you local physics in 5-dimensional anti-de Sitter, even though it's a 4-dimensional CFT. And of course, these statements have been checked, can be checked, in n equal 4 super Young Mills. So these are not assumptions. Once you assume them, once you prove them, and from the structure of conformal blocks, you can essentially convince yourself that locality is there in the vacuum. Now, I used here Poincaré coordinates. It is actually, for the next question, simpler to go to global coordinates, where anti-de Sitter is a box. It confines things in the middle, because there is an infinite. So the boundary is not anymore a plane, but a sphere times time. And if you try to go to the boundary, there is infinite blue shift, so you come back in. And now, let's think now about this problem, and I'm done in a few minutes. So we still have now super Young Mills defined on S3 times R. The gravitational description tells us that radiation is reflected at the boundary of the Sitter. And if you work it out, there are 2 kinds of black holes in this system. There are so-called small black holes that are like the Schwarzschild black holes. They come in and evaporate. But there's another kind of black hole. If you put enough energy into this, you drive the temperature very high, since the radiation cannot escape, that's a trap, you will reach thermal equilibrium. And for a high enough temperature, this thermal equilibrium geometric state is a so-called large ADS black hole with a big horizon. It's not simply a free gas of gluons, of gravitons in anti-de Sitter. It's called the Hawking-Page transition. So at a sufficiently high energy, you may then say that a typical state of the quantum field theory made out of order n square operators, that's the correct energy, should resemble a large ADS black hole. And now we have a problem. Okay, can we reconstruct this geometry from normal quantum field theory? And this is now a geometry that has a horizon and a space-like singularity. Here is the geometry. You know, there's no way out here. There is a horizon, and you just crunch. You know, if you just solve the Einstein equations, that's what you find. That's the Penrose diagram. Actually, this is an eternal black hole. This is the exterior. This is the black hole interior. So if you create the black hole with an infalling shell, you don't get this full diagram. This full diagram is, so, in a sense, the Kruskal maximal extension of the black hole, and it has a white hole on the mirror. But the main point I want to make is that there is a horizon and a space-like singularity. So what will conformal field theory do about that? You know, now, in a sense, we are really stuck with a problem. So since the black hole does not evaporate, the final singularity in gravity is unavoidable. But if this is string theory or super Young Mills, it must be possible to understand why and how the effective field theory breaks down. It better break down, because there cannot be such a singularity in super Young Mills. Notice that the Hartle-Hawking assumption or things like that will not help here, because the singularity is a crunch. I mean, you are just ending there. It's not some initial condition. So what can you do? Again, people have tried all sorts of exotica, you know, and That's a fair game, you know, when you are faced with such a question, why not try anything? Here is a real exotica, for instance, it's called post-selection or a final state boundary condition at the singularity. Here is a formula that Jurg loves very much. This is basically the probability of successive measurements in time, A1, A2 up to AN, giving specific values, A1, A2, AN. And this proposal says, well, we have to stick in also some kind of density matrix for the final state. But that's, you know, even I cannot swallow this. That's catastrophic because you violate the one rule we may want to keep, namely that the result of an experiment of n minus one measurements doesn't depend on the nth measurement you may want to make later in time. You know, I mean, if this was true, then all notion of causality would go. So, for instance, this is an exotic proposal that I find very hard to accept. Well, let's take a closer look, actually. Long after the black hole has formed, near the horizon, the geometry, as usual, looks like empty locally Minkowski space. And in terms of the coordinates of an infalling observer, these are the Rindler coordinates, the vacuum somewhere here looks like a thermal vacuum. You can, you know, make this very precise. So there are the modes that are defined, say, at some given time t. These are the horizons. At a given time t, there are the right and the left modes. The right modes are the only ones that can escape out to infinity. So they are the only ones that propagate to the boundary where the conformal field theory is defined. So if you are going to make an effort to reconstruct the geometry beyond the horizon, you have to say something about the other half of the modes, the left modes. Are these made of operators in the same Hilbert space or not? Here are three answers, okay. No. That's in a sense leading you to the unavoidable conclusion called the firewall. Why? Well, you can see it in the figure. If these are totally independent modes, who tells me that this state has been prepared so carefully that all sorts of quanta don't propagate from this side into the black hole interior? And then when I'm falling in from this side, I will be hit by all sorts of radiation. So to avoid the firewall, if the L modes were completely independent, acting in a different Hilbert space than the R modes, would require a very big fine-tuning of the state of this system, and we know nothing about it. So the other answer is yes. But then, you see, if these L modes were acting on exactly the same Hilbert space as the R modes, you would get into another problem. Then the infalling observer can act on the same Hilbert space states as the guy outside, and then why can't he send a signal to him, right? I mean, if he has access to exactly the same Hilbert space, 3 minutes and then, and he can modify things, then he can send signals. But remember, this is a horizon. A guy in here can never, forever communicate anymore with the outside. So, you know, both run into trouble. And now here is a third, and I think probably most reasonable proposal, proposed by these two young guys, Papadoudimas and Raju, in a series of papers. And the answer is yes, in a restricted sense. And, unfortunately, the construction is state-dependent. I'll tell you what I mean, and then I'm basically done. Let me simply say that the idea looks promising, but it still must overcome, I think, many, many hurdles. State dependence, causality, and still it won't really tell us what happens at the final singularity. But the idea of these people is to essentially mimic, in an approximate way, the Tomita Takesaki construction of observables. So they say the following: let's consider a typical highly excited state psi of the conformal field theory. That's a typical state that has enough energy to be a black hole. Now, the algebra of observables, and this is something Jurg would absolutely agree, is really a very small algebra. you don't want to use any possible operator, because in particular there would be operators that destroy the black hole. But the only experiments we do are basically perturbing a little the state. So let me think of an algebra that does not alter drastically the state. In particular, the operators never annihilate the state of the black hole. This is the state dependence of the operators we are going to look at. Okay. Now, this cannot really be an algebra either, and that's where, you know, more mathematically stronger people, in my opinion, can come in and try to settle some of the points. In particular, we want to avoid n square fold products of these operators, because these are precisely the kind of things that would annihilate the original state. So it's an algebra in the sense that you can add things, but you cannot arbitrarily multiply things. Now, if you assume all this, then by mimicking essentially this construction, you can show indeed that one may construct an isomorphic algebra, a tilde, which commutes with A, and such that the O tilde and O operators are exactly entangled thermally in the particular state psi. Okay. It may sound tautological, but it tells you...
What does it mean to have entangled operators?
Oh, it means that if you expand out the state in eigenstates of this operator, you will find exactly what you expect from a thermally entangled state. So remember, you will basically reconstruct this Rindler state that I flashed by you, maybe somewhere here. Here, yeah. Since I see David getting up, let me just finish and then we can discuss it more. But in a sense, what this tells you is that you can try to construct the modes behind the horizon, which are thermally entangled with the modes outside. It will only be an effective description, and more importantly, it will depend on psi. So every time you change psi, it will be a different set of operators. Now, you may say that's it, no point in considering it, but in a sense, maybe that's what we need to describe in a background independent way the geometry of an infalling observer. So I'm done. I think, you know, the merit of this is that it helps to sharpen a little the puzzles in some very definite setting, put them in a context where, in principle, with unlimited technical prowess, they could be answered. But actual string theory calculations have been very hard to use in this debate, and some people have still have been brave enough to try them. You know, it is a well-known fact that high-energy scattering of strings is non-local in the sense that strings stretch out to arbitrary transverse size, and many people feel that this should still play a role in the resolution, and it doesn't at all in this Papadudimas-Razor resolution. So I'm not sure what the final story is, but I think it's a well-defined problem for once, and something should come out of it. Thank you very much.
We have time for brief questions.
Yes. No, I want to make a remark, because Costas discussed about this geometries. So the point is, for extreme or supersymmetric black holes, at this point, you have constructed enough states, what you believe to be enough states to account for the entropy. So there, I think it's established that you have this singularity, which is time-like.
For the three charge, right? You mean black hole?
Uh-huh. Which is time-like, which gets resolved on a large macroscopic distance. And the reason is very simple. Singularities in string theory contain low mass degrees of freedom. And because it's a low mass degrees of freedom, it affects the physics on a large scale. So when you approach a singularity, you can say, I have a singularity, the curvature blows up, I can stay 5 kilometers away and I can do physics. This is wrong. When you go near a singularity, if the curvature is large here, you can have a low mass degrees of freedom, which can affect you at 1 kiloparsec away and can destroy your physics. So you cannot do local physics whenever you have a singularity.
The only, if I may say, comment, I mean, of course, that would be marvelous if it's true.
Even supersymmetric black holes, that's basically.
But then one would have to understand why in this room effective field theory in approximately Minkowski space-time is valid, if there is a singularity in Andromeda or in the other side of the universe. And that's the real issue, right? I mean, if one gets some understanding of this, then it would be marvelous, I agree.